A theology, medicine, and culture initiative at Duke Divinity School, in partnership with the Christian Medical and Dental Associations, welcomes you to our lecture series entitled Jesus and Medicine. What does Christianity have to offer healthcare?
Hey, my name is Brett McCarty. I'm an assistant research professor of theological ethics here at Duke Divinity School, where I'm also associate director of the Theology, Medicine, and Culture Initiative. Ask a student why they're studying to become a nurse or a doctor, and you're likely to get an answer along the lines of, well, I really want to help people. And if you talk a bit further about why they have such a desire, they may eventually say something like, there's something about sick people that deserves our care. Or some will even quote the Bible saying, we should be committed to helping the least of these. Why do we think this way? We take such commitments to be fairly self-evident and in need of little justification. But healthcare hasn't always been committed in this way, and it may not always continue to do so forever. This commitment to care for the sick is a moral achievement, one developed over time and so in need of continual renewal. I want to spend some time today examining the role played by Christianity in creating some of the moral world often taken for granted in modern medicine. We'll do so not through sweeping historical and philosophical arguments, though those do exist. Instead, I want to focus in on the story of one particular Christian, Basil of Caesarea, or as some know him, St. Basil the Great. He lived over 1,600 years ago, and I think we have much to learn from him today. And that's especially true for Christians committed to caring for the body. Basil was born into a wealthy and powerful Christian family filled with strong personalities, and their expectations for him and their perceptions of him mattered a great deal for Basil throughout his life. For much of his youth, he followed the path to success that they laid out, receiving an excellent classical education that prepared him for a life of civic achievement. He even spent several years studying in Athens, that center of philosophy. Although the city had fallen a bit from its earlier glory, it was still renowned worldwide. There, in Athens, Basil was a student for a while alongside the future Roman Emperor Julian. We'll return to him in a moment. So here we have this well-off young man with an elite education, set off on a trajectory of success by his family, making it in the world. But as much as Basil always appreciated both his classical education and his family's understanding of what his life should look like, he also worked to discern for himself what God's call was on his life. And so he left Athens and set off to learn from holy women and men living in the deserts of Syria and Egypt. He found their witness compelling, and for a time thought that perhaps a life of solitude and prayer was for him. But Basil eventually realized that friendship was essential for his own life of faith, and so with a group of friends, he founded a Christian community near where he grew up. And while this community was deeply formative for him, Basil ultimately came to understand that living as part of the church in the world was his call. And so he settled into life as a priest and then a bishop in Caesarea, the major city in that region. So Basil's journey took him through the formations of family, of classical education, of ascetical life, both in solitude and community. He received gifts from each of these formations, even as he settled into a life that didn't fit neatly into any of their expectations. And it's through his work in Caesarea that we see Basil become a part of a movement to transform how we see people and care for them in society. To understand this, we need a bit of context about care in the ancient Greco-Roman world, both for how it was given and in who received it. In that age, the commitment to care was centered around cities and their citizens. Huge gifts would be given for the glory of a particular place, like Corinth or Ephesus, and for its citizens. We see these on display today as decaying marble monuments when we travel around the Mediterranean. And if we're honest, it's not a concept that's far from us. Think of our own universities, filled with majestic buildings and endowed scholarships named for rich donors. They're given for the benefit and the glory of a particular school and those who belong to it. The same is true for many ballparks and public works in our cities today. What's key, however, is that in the Greco-Roman world, these gifts weren't given for the benefit of the poor, because society didn't think in terms of moral obligations to the poor. In that world, there were citizens of various sorts of social classes, and then there was everyone else, from slaves to immigrants to rural farmers. These non-citizens and their needs weren't really part of the governing moral calculus. Instead, the elites of society were honored and praised for loving their city and those who belonged to it. In contrast, Christian elites, and the bishops in particular, became known as lovers of the poor. Steeped in Jewish commitments, Christian care became a rival way of structuring the Greco-Roman world. Rather than a social world divided between citizens and non-citizens, Christians imagine a world divided between rich and poor. All of society, especially its elites, was to be morally committed to care for the poor. This radical reordering of societal norms, of what was seen as praiseworthy, was a true innovation. As the historian Peter Brown says, to put it bluntly, in a sense, it was the Christian bishops who invented the poor. This invention transformed the ancient world's moral landscape and everything within it, from how plague victims were treated to whether unwanted children were left in the wilderness to die. As evidence of this, we return to Julian, who went on from being a classmate of Basil's in Athens to emperor of the known world. Julian was the last pagan Roman emperor, and he aimed to restore the glory of the Roman gods in an empire that was becoming Christian. But to do so, he had to use moral categories that were shifting in response to Jewish and Christian care. In a well-known letter, Julian ordered the creation of a system of poor relief in Galatia modeled on Jewish and Christian charity. And as justification for his command, Julian said, "For it is disgraceful that when no Jew ever has to beg, and the impious Galileans, that is the Christians, support not only their own poor but ours as well, all men see that our people lack aid from us," that is, from the pagan priesthood. End quote. Here we see on display how the moral vision of the entire Greco-Roman world was transformed through the witness of care for the least of these. Julian's reforms were short-lived, as he died only a few years as emperor while fighting in what is now known as modern-day Iraq. But with this emerging commitment to care for the poor in mind, we can now return to Basil and his own contributions to this transformation. A few years after Julian's death, Basil became a priest in Caesarea. When the surrounding land suffered a devastating drought, Basil preached a moving series of sermons exhorting the wealthy to open their stores of grain to help feed the poor. "The hungry are dying before your face," Basil proclaimed, and the rich responded with generosity. And in the midst of responding to the immediate needs of the hungry, Basil became a bishop and began work on a remarkable institutional innovation. There, on the outskirts of classical Caesarea, he sought to build an alternate social order, one that physically displayed what a world devoted to care for the poor might look like. And so Basil developed a complex of institutions committed to charitable care for the elderly, the poor, migrants, and others. He referred to it by a variety of names, but others named it after him, calling it the Basileus. Within it was what many consider to be the first hospital, that is, the first inpatient facility staffed by trained medical practitioners and open to caring for anyone who is sick, not just those who can pay or those who might belong to a certain group of people, like soldiers. Historian Andrew Crislip summarizes the institution as, quote, "a charitable hospital in which the poor could receive treatment from monastics, nurses, and doctors. They were prepared for their discharge and for reintegration into healthy society, not only physically, but also morally and economically," end quote. And so we come to the heart of why Basil is worth consideration by Christians involved in healthcare today. Quite simply, he invented the hospital. The Basileus was sustained by deep theological commitments to care for those who are sick and poor. And to understand this more, we turn to the testimony of some of the people closest to Basil: his brother, Gregory of Nyssa, and his friend, Gregory of Nazianzus. In a sermon, Gregory of Nyssa invokes Matthew 25 in the Last Judgment, in which all will be held accountable for what they have done for the sick, as the least of these. He proclaims that the sick, quote, "bear the countenance of our Savior," end quote. This identification between the sick and the person of Jesus Christ creates a Christological depth to every medical encounter. Every time a Christian medical practitioner enters a patient's room, he or she should prepare to meet Jesus. When taken seriously, this is a transformative commitment and is in the roots of the institution of the hospital itself. And then Gregory of Nazianzus turns to the example of Basil's own care for the sick. Basil received a basic medical education as part of his time in Athens, and he evidently put it to use in Caesarea through a radical embrace of the marginalized sick. As his friend describes it, quote, "Therefore Basil greeted the sick like brothers. He set us an example by his own Christian spirit of approaching them and caring for their bodies. A mute but eloquent exhortation. Others had their cooks and rich tables and enchanting refinements of cuisine and elegant marriages and soft-flowing garments. Basil had his sick and the dressing of their wounds and the imitation of Christ, cleansing leprosy not by word, but in deed." End quote. If we take Basil's own example seriously then, those caring for the sick both imitate Christ and humbly prepare to meet him. Now, there are two more features worth noting about Basil's story. First, even as he developed a Christian commitment to care for the least of these that stood in sharp contrast to a Greco-Roman desire for the glory of a city and its citizens, Basil himself was willing to work closely, though always carefully, with people deeply entwined with that old world. Over a series of letters, Basil made a vigorous case to elite Roman civic officials that this charitable work deserved imperial support, both through direct gifts and concessions on taxes for those involved. For Basil, caring for the sick and the poor was a crucial part of the church's claim to receive special recognition from the government. Moreover, Basil worked directly with the Emperor Valens, who himself supported Basil's charitable work as part of visits to the region. This collaboration stands out because Valens belonged to a strand of Christianity that followed the teachings of Arius. And Basil was one of the key opponents of how Arius understood the relations between God the Father and God the Son. The position that Basil supported was officially ratified a few years after his death. You all may know it as the Nicene Creed. So then, the second distinctive feature is that Basil was willing to work with people he disagreed with theologically in order to pursue this commitment to care, although he never compromised on his own theological convictions. Therefore, in the life of Basil and in the founding of the first hospital, we see a willingness to work with unlikely allies to pursue the local common good. Why then do those training to be doctors and nurses want to help people? I've tried to show today how the answer to that question depends, in some small way, on the witness of Basil of Caesarea. In several ways, then, his life is worth considering today. For those trying to navigate family expectations of success, Basil offers a fruitful tension, pairing continued grateful connection to family with a willingness to follow the call of God into new paths. For people trying to navigate what it means to be educated and formed in our contemporary world, Basil offers a complicated example, receiving gifts from what we might call secular education, monastic retreats, and intentional Christian communities. For healthcare practitioners wondering if they should work within the system or outside of it, Basil in some ways refuses the dichotomy, as he works with the powers that be to carve out a space to faithfully care for the least of these, transforming the entire system in the process. What might it mean for healthcare practitioners today to follow Christ as they prepare to meet Jesus and those who are sick? We all live on the other side of the world that Basil helped to create, and so we can turn to his witness in gratitude even as we recognize that we face new and distinct challenges today. But there's an excitement that comes with this as well, as God is inviting healthcare practitioners to discern anew what it means to serve faithfully within the world of healthcare, and perhaps even transform it a bit through your witness. Thank you.
For reflection questions and other resources, visit tmc.divinity.duke.edu/jesusandmedicine.